This episode of Another Happy Pod is going to contain spoilers. If you've not experienced the content yourself, please go ahead and do so before coming back and listening to the boys ramble on about it. Thank you very much.
Hello and welcome to Another Happy Pod. My name is Nathan. As always, I'm joined by Lawrence, who is a well. Hello, Lawrence. Welcome to the show.
Hello, Nathan. I see I'm dusting off the censored sound effect again. It's been a while.
Lawrence, tell the people who don't know that you're a what this show is about.
This show, Nathan, for those that don't know that I'm a is when we get together and we talk about the things that we like in movies, pop culture, so TV, games, la-di-da.
Okay, so what you're saying is, or what you're trying to say, but doing a terrible job of it, is basically you're trying to say that we discuss pop culture and try to keep things a little bit lighthearted and positive.
And breezy. Don't forget breezy.
Yeah, well, that's already gone out the window. What's going on?
What's going on is that you're currently fiddling with your pen.
I meant, you know, more in the realm of, do you have a question?
Or I do, but I thought we like to normally have a little build-up before that, don't we?
Yeah, but let's just get into it.
Let's just get it done. Another happy question. Yeah. All right, I did warn you before we recorded, this question is bottom of the barrel stuff. I used up my good one last week. So the question I have for you, this movie had the tremendous task of recasting the iconic dads of the Mamma Mia franchise, who are Colin Firth, Stellan Skarsgård, and Pierce Brosnan. If you could choose three different iconic male actors to play the three dads, who would you choose?
You weren't lying when you said
it's
that.
Bottom of the barrel.
You could have even gone like, who would you want as a celebrity to play your dad? Or anything else.
Do you know, it was painful just watching you put less than 5 seconds of thought into it and come up with something immediately better.
Yeah. But no, let's go with that. Right. I'll have a good hard think about that one.
In fairness, I can think of one, but I haven't got an answer for the other two.
I'll be honest with you. We was gonna record this podcast early, so I watched this movie like a week ago, and I've forgotten most of it.
So take it away, Lawrence. Is that what's going on?
I mean, I got notes. I don't know what half of them mean.
So. Okay. I'll tell you what, let's work through them. Give us your first note.
All right, first note. Donna's dead with four question marks. Oh, by the way, we're doing Mamma Mia, Here We Go Again.
Yeah, it's that one. It's the second one. Here We Go Again sequel. Also.
An original sequel, because obviously the first movie is based on a musical, which does not have a sequel. So they decided, let's just make one up. And boy, does it show. because I also, a spoiler alert for one of my notes as well, wow, they really did use all the good ABBA songs in the first movie, didn't they?
They really did. It's very telling. No, do you know how hard I had to keep my mouth shut last week, just knowing the twists and turns of Mamma Mia 2, Here We Go Again?
It was a roller coaster of twists and turns.
It was indeed. No, so they... I often think, let's, all right, so that's, yeah, Donna's dead. I don't know why.
Okay, no, yeah, me neither. For the majority of the movie, I was just assuming, I was like, oh, well, just Meryl Streep didn't come back. She just didn't want to do it,
yeah.
Which is fair enough. Meryl Streep has literally never done a sequel before, so that makes sense. She just didn't come back, so they just wrote in that she died. No, not the case.
No.
Not the case, because she is in the movie. For the last 10 minutes, if that.
It just strikes me as the weirdest choice, because she's the get of the first one. She's the selling point. You've got the dads, but it's centered around Meryl Streep. She's the big one in that.
Yeah.
And then in the second one, they're like, she's dead. She's just dead now.
It's weird because the budget for this movie is noticeably bigger than the first.
Yeah.
It's like watching High School Musical 3 compared to High School Musical 2, when they use literally like a fucking picture as a set.
Yeah.
And now there's actual money and they can actually build a school and all
now,
this
now,
shit.
Now the high school is rotating.
Exactly. There's obviously noticeably money in the production now. Not that there wasn't money in the first one, just there's a lot more money in this one, which is very obvious. But for a lot of it, it felt cheaper. And it felt like a cheap sequel where they couldn't get the cast back from the first one. But then they did. Because when the movie started, I was like, okay, no Meryl Streep, she's not coming back, that's fair enough. And then Amanda Seyfried was like, oh, only one of my dads can come here, because I've got three dads, remember? Only one of my three dads can come to this reunion. So I was like, oh, you only got Piers, Colin Firth, and Stan didn't want to be in the movie? Oh, okay, that's kind of dumb, that's kind of...
It does set it up like that, and actually, doesn't it?
I was like that for a lot of the movie, and then the movie's like, no... They're here. They are in the movie. We just made you think that they're not.
Their story arc in this one is traveling to Greece. I mean,
essentially. Yeah. And then they show up and they sing Dancing Queen or whatever. And that was great.
I know what you mean about it feeling cheaper, though, because it does have a noticeably cheaper vibe to it. Like, the graduation is in, like, one hall. It's little things like they're in Paris, except they're just not in Paris.
So because Don is dead, for some inexplicable fucking reason, they have young Donna, as played by Lily James, and they do the flashback, the origin of Amanda Seyfried, basically.
The origin story of it, yeah.
Yeah, they do Donna's origin. Here's three men that I shagged in a short space of time. It very much seems like... what am I trying to say here? I feel like it's interesting because the first movie doesn't tell you who her dad is, and it annoyingly goes out of his way not to tell you, which I'm still mad about.
Yeah.
But then I feel like this one is like, oh no, it's Pierce Brosnan.
It does feel very much like it is, because also it's also implied that they were there for like 3 weeks, so I'd assume they had sex more than once.
Exactly, yeah. And then, like, it was definitely not Colin Firth, don't worry about him. She had sex with him once and it was terrible. And then she never saw him again, so don't worry about him. But then, yeah, she was shagging James Bond for a few weeks.
Yeah.
And then the moment he left, she hooked up with Stan Skarsgård once and then was immediately morning sick. So it very much seems like it's...
And the movie kind of wrote, like... I don't know if this is telling towards who the real father is or whether they ever had it in mind, but they wrote Stellan Skarsgård's, or they wrote Harry off, no, they wrote Bill off to be with...
Who's Bill? I don't know the name.
Right, we'll do actors' names again.
Yes.
they kind of wrote Stellan Skarsgård's character into the box of, you know, he's with the other woman, he's with Julie Walters, and they gayed Colin Firth. Out of nowhere.
But then didn't.
So it kind of feels like the movie is picking a side, but also being like, "Ooh, we're not going to tell you because the musical never told you." Yeah.
But I feel like they kind of did tell us, which is good because I wanted an answer, and it kind of makes sense for it to be Pierce Brosnan, really.
But then just say it. Do you know what I mean?
just say it. Don't be a coward. You know, just fucking say it. I'd say that though. I do like Pierce Brosnan's dad energy in this movie.
Yeah,
he has very gentle dad energy.
Yeah.
Which I like. He's quite good actually for the most part. You really believe that he does miss Donna. And I like that he lives on the island still, and he's still a part of Amanda Seyfried's life and everything like that. I like that. That's quite cute.
Imagine if we just... I'll be honest, I came back to do Donna a few more times, and now I'm off. Yeah. I tell you what, if you like Pierce Brosnan, what do you think of... What the younger cast, what do you make of him?
All right, Lily James is great.
Yeah.
Lily James can do no wrong...
apart from the Drake. Potato party peel.
We don't talk about the peel potato pie society. I've never even seen it.
it's not bad, to be honest.
Never seen it, never will, don't care. It's just a weird name for a movie. I was gonna say, yeah, Lily James is great. She's great as young Meryl, you know, great singer voice, nothing wrong to say about her. I feel like some of the dads are good. Everyone's fine. No one does an offensive job.
I think that the performances are all fine. It shines that they're cast quite well.
Yeah,
the actors don't have to do much, but they're just cast well.
It's they're doing very good impressions of the older cast. And sometimes it is a bit of an impression, but that's all right. You have a little bit of fun with it.
Well, the young Pierce Brosnan is very much doing an impression of Pierce Brosnan.
Yes, but his accent does change between British and American quite a bit.
Yeah. That, I like that. Is the guy that voices Harry, the guy that plays young Colin Firth, is he British?
I don't know, but I did say something about him, because there was something in my mind that I just could not get out of my head. Young Harry reminds me so much of Matt Smith.
Oh my god, yeah, fuck.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, oh my god, I do. Oh, that's a bit weird, isn't it? Yeah. Like, he doesn't flip his accent at all. It's very British, but it sounds almost like what an American person doing a British accent would sound like.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I can't be certain.
Amanda Seyfried is fine. I'll tell you who's not fine.
I was hoping you'd get there.
Why are you Cher in this movie? And why is she playing Donna's mum? Who I'm pretty sure, by the way, in the first movie she was dead.
Yeah. See, so she never... There's a loophole there, because they never said she was dead, but Donna made it...
They've said something like her mother's looking down on her now or something.
Yeah, there's always someone up there that's got it in for her, probably my mother or something is the line.
There you go. That, come on.
she was dead until they got Cher in the movie.
Yeah, okay. So Cher is in the movie. Cher shows up to do nothing apart from sing Fernando. And Fernando is the hotel manager who's been there all along, apparently.
So a few problems. Firstly, I disagree that Cher shows up to do nothing. I think Cher turns up to hijack the third act and dedicate way too much screen time to her being like, I'm a grandma.
Yeah.
And it's like...
And maybe Fernando is Donna's dad.
Yeah.
Maybe.
And also, Donna's name was Sheridan. Or Cher's name was something Sheridan.
Yeah.
The guy has come to this island... where presumably he had at least one conversation with Cher about her daughter who moved to this island. Yeah. And he's like, hey, Sophie Sheridan, I'm going to manage this island. And then just never thought about it ever again.
Yeah, that's pretty strange. I initially thought when, do you know, when they're doing the flashback and young Donna and Stellan Skarsgård are on the boat, and then they stop that wedding with the guy, and they stop that wedding.
Oh, yeah.
I initially thought that was the young hotel manager, and that's why he's stuck around, and he's just a part of her life.
It's a fucking small world, isn't it?
It is. I thought that was the same guy.
Yeah.
It's not, because then he shows up later in the movie with a bunch of boats, and he's like, hey, you're my friend, or whatever. So I thought, when that first happened, I was like, oh, that's cute. That's pretty cute. I like that. But then it just turns out I was wrong.
Yeah.
So, fuck me, I guess.
And the worst thing is, I liked him. I liked his addition until they just made him Cher's man that she's come back for. I actually liked the character.
They just made him Fernando for no reason.
Yeah.
It's big. They wrote him in because ABBA had a song called Fernando.
That they hadn't used yet.
I tell you what, bloody hell, Lily James goes to Paris at one point. ABBA have a song called Waterloo. The French did a big battle in Waterloo. So maybe we can make that work. let's say they go to a revolutionary themed restaurant, because those are a thing. Have a nice dinner and then sing about Napoleon.
Because... When I was in the cinema watching this for the first time, I saw what the waiters were wearing and I went, yeah, we fucking go.
Here we go. Get ready, boy.
So fun fact, Cher is only in this because she was also releasing an album of ABBA covers at the time.
Oh, great. Okay.
And Mamma Mia got wind of it. And she's actually a big reason why the sequel even got made.
Okay.
So this boil it down to this entire movie as a promotional tool for a Cher album that no one asked for.
Yeah, that's fair.
And do you know the worst thing about it? Cher, famously very talented singer, the worst covers of the movie.
Yeah.
It's just not an enjoyable rendition.
it's not her voice doesn't suit ABBA, I don't think, really. ABBA's all very upbeat and happy, and she's got quite a deep register.
Yeah.
Does which is, for Cher's music, that's great. But for ABBA, it doesn't really work. This movie makes no fucking sense.
On what level?
It does make sense, all right? But the world as a whole... No, actually, I retract that. This movie makes no fucking sense. So, this movie opens, and correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong, okay? But this... Well, it doesn't open. But when the flashbacks start, when we go back and we see young Donna, mm-hmm. it very specifically says 1979. And then she goes to Paris, and then she goes to Greece, and this all happens over a summer, okay? Over one summer.
Yeah.
She's not there years. She's there over the one summer. She meets the three blokes. She gets pregnant.
Yeah.
Meaning Amanda Seyfried would have been born at the latest in 1980. Okay?
Right, yeah.
And they say in the first movie she's 20 years old.
She should be 28.
Meaning the first movie takes place in 2000. In this movie, they say it's been 5 years since the first movie. First of all, that's fucking generous, okay? But, all right.
It's very generous.
It's very generous, Amanda Seyfried.
Oh, wait, no, saying... Oh, no, has it been a year since Donna died, or has it been 5 years since Donna died?
No, because Amanda Seyfried says to her Nana, you've had 25 years to make a difference, as in, be a part of her life.
Oh, that was a brave choice.
when she said that, I was like, wow, okay, you've been very generous to yourself there, but... Yeah. No disrespect. That was a very disrespectful thing I said, but she doesn't look 25.
No, but also I think of any of them, she's the most believable. She doesn't look 25, but she looks a lot closer to 25 than Dominic Cooper fucking does.
Yeah, he could be older. He can be older, I guess. But true. Still, this movie is telling me it's set in 2005. This movie is not set in 2005. There's no fucking way.
Yeah.
There's no... First of all, Harry's using a fucking Windows Surface Pro in Tokyo.
Yeah.
Right?
Sky's got an iPhone.
Sky's got an iPhone. It's not set in 2005.
Yeah.
So, what's going on? The timeline is fucked. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I didn't even think about that. Somehow there's more inconsistencies in this the more you think about it. So obviously we know the first movie was a bit of fun. They had the flashbacks to the three dads of the era. Who were obviously they weren't going to get Pierce Brosnan to convincingly play a 20-year-old. It's not happening. But yeah, there's other things as well. So for example, Sophie tells the story of the encounters in the opening of Mamma Mia. The retelling in Mamma Mia, Here We Go Again, is completely the wrong order. They're also nothing like the counterparts would suggest.
Yeah.
I.e., they basically gave young Colin Firth a leather jacket and went, that's enough rocking for you, I think. There's quite a lot in this. There is quite a lot of inconsistencies.
The timeline is a big issue for me, and I don't like it, because it's such an easy fix. It's very easy. Just to say a different year. Or not say any year.
Yeah.
Better yet, don't say any year. The worst thing you could have done is say 1979.
If you the easy cheat to this is just don't say what year it is, and instead of saying a year in your flashback, just say 20 years later. Or earlier. Yeah. So before we go any further, I really want to talk about Dominic Cooper in this movie.
Oh yeah, he is in it.
He's in it. I laughed in the cinema when I watched this scene. The song One of Us. Now, this is the one where Sophie first calls Sky and he's just been offered a job. He's in New York he's in his hotel room. I don't know if you remember it too well.
He's got a picture of New York on his hotel wall.
Yeah, he does.
Or on his wall.
He does. But no amount of scene transitions. And there are so many in this number. There's upwards of 11 scene transitions just to cut from one of those verse to another one. No amount of them can save me from the fact that Dominic Cooper looks like he's being fucking held at gunpoint to record that song. I respect it if you're just going to come on set for a bag, but at least try. Try a little bit.
Yeah, again, though, he didn't really try in the first one, so
yeah,
it was in keeping with his character. Sorry, I'm just on IMDb and I can just see here, quotes, Tanya, be still my beating vagina.
That's a good... She's got some good ones. She consistently remains to be one of the best parts of the movie.
Yeah, young Tanya was very good.
Yeah.
So yeah, so that's all very good. Well, it's not, but you know, it is what it is. Did she send out the invites for her big reunion the day before it happened?
It seems so.
It does, doesn't it?
And bearing in mind, you're off the fucking... a tiny island off of Greece.
Most of these invites are going, you would assume, to America. Sure, why not send them the day before? Let people book a flight and just come on down.
In other words, they'd have to get them and rewind time to get there.
Exactly.
It's just as well that it got cancelled and it was unsalvageable until it was completely salvageable.
Yeah, exactly. It was. Look, there's no ferries. They can't cross the sea because it's too dangerous. So instead, they'll just cross the sea.
In fairness, they're not on ferries. They make friends with a man they all met 20 years ago. Or something.
Yeah, but they still cross the sea.
It's just a bunch of fishermen. Just to rock up to the party. If I was Sophie, I'd be like, this is fine, but also...
Yeah. I did like that they all rock up singing Dancing Queen, but they was also all singing it together. Like, there was probably about a good, I don't know, like a good 2 miles of distance between the people on the boats and the people up on the island watching them. But they were still singing Dancing Queen back and forth to each other.
Yeah, of course.
That was quite impressive. It reminded me, you know that scene in Shazam where they're having like the big villain monologue in the sky and then it just cuts back to Shazam and he's like, what?
Oh, yeah, and he's like, I can't fucking hear you at all. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. It just reminded me of that.
No, it's accurate. I almost like it's almost one of them scenes you want to see the realistic edit of, just a bunch of shuffling sound effects and people singing, but it's too far away to make out.
Yeah.
Stellan Skarsgård has a fat twin brother for maybe winner of the world's worst cutaway gag.
I have a note here that says, "Oh, not the fat suit." What was the point in that?
Yeah.
Because it's just a nothing scene. It's so pointless. Why does he have a twin brother and why is he fat? It's just so great, okay, I guess.
Yeah, and also no one would notice that Bill, who is not that fat, has suddenly got much larger for one speech.
Yeah.
Only to slim down maybe in his next public appearance.
Yeah. There was absolutely no point in it, really. Yeah. It was just there, look, Bill's let himself go. Nah, not really.
Not really.
He's all right.
He's still Stellan Skarsgård, a man in his 60s.
Great.
Yeah, cool.
Well, I was worried then. I was worried a man had gotten fat for a second.
Yeah, a man who is aging. My goodness, why is he not in peak physical condition?
great stuff.
Anyway. On slightly out of taste things, Toshiko from Torchwood shows up to do a very, very stereotypical Chinese accent.
Does she? Who is she?
She's the contract negotiator for Colin Firth's scene in the boardroom.
Oh, is she? Oh, is that her?
Yeah.
Oh.
She shows up doing a very... I don't quite know it, what accent they're going for, but it's not hers.
Mad in Japanese.
Yeah, it's not hers, and it doesn't sound too tasteful, in my opinion.
Right. Well, there we go, then.
There you go.
Well, lovely stuff. What else happens in this?
Madam Hooch is in it as Donna's teacher.
Is she?
Yeah, Madam Hooch is the Scottish teacher that goes, what am I de?
It's not Madam Hooch, is it?
I promise you it's Madam Hooch, yeah. You're looking it up. We're having another one of those moments where I go, oh God, I really hope it's Madam Hooch. Madam Hooch is what all the boys call me when I've got a few ciders in the park.
She's not Madam Hooch, mate. You fucked up.
Not after all this time spent calling her Madam Hooch. Is it not Madam Hooch?
It's not Madam Hooch. I fucking knew it wasn't.
Fuck, who is it?
You fucking stupid cunt.
Is she in anything?
She's in everything. She's in Nanny McPhee. It's Celia Imrie who's... But Madam Hooch is fucking...
I just googled Madam Hooch. It doesn't even look like Madam Hooch.
Exactly. I fucking knew it didn't.
Oh, I really fucked it up. I've been called out. Do you know, for 2 years I've been saying that's Madame Hooch.
Looks nothing like her as well. It looks absolutely nothing like her. Zoe Wanamaker is Madame Hooch.
I've never felt embarrassment quite like this before.
Yeah, she's in my family. Yeah, I fucking knew it. Not fucking...
Damn.
What an absolute fool you are.
Oh, no.
Don't ever test me. She's Lady Cassandra from Doctor Who.
That's it! That's who I'm thinking of!
Madame Cassandra... Madame Hooch is Lady Cassandra, you dickhead.
Fuck.
You fucked up, mate.
No, fuck. Okay. Shit.
Terrible.
All right, well, yeah. thank you for calling me. At least we know this podcast has some integrity left, and I'm not just sprouting facts. I have taken the L, Nathan. Good. Would you like me to do the Fortnite dance?
No, you don't have to.
There's a shot in this movie. Let's just move on from that. There's a shot in this movie where Lily James pokes a horse in the eye at a pivotal emotional beat. Couldn't have just done another take of that. It's right after she gets broken up with by Pierce Brosnan. Or not broken up with, she finds out he's cheating on her or something. And she goes to stroke the horse, but she just outright pokes it straight in the eye, and the horse obviously gets pissed off. Good little moment in this. What do you think of the numbers in this?
I remember specifically thinking all the best songs are in the first movie, which is evident given the fact they do fucking half of them again. I don't know. You have to work with what you have, I guess. Waterloo, fine. You know, it's a fun song. Makes no sense in the movie.
No.
It's like last week we said, Does Your Mama Know is the most forced in one. That's probably the most forced in.
I think Fernando's the most forced in this one.
To be fair, they're all pretty forced.
But in terms of sculpting the plot around a song, Waterloo is up there.
It was very much Glee vibes once again.
Choreography is good in that though. They're sword fighting with bread rolls and stuff. Like, it's fun.
Yeah, it's all a good bit of fun. But again, I just don't care about any of it.
I just think it's more exciting than watching people run around the same island 20 times.
Yeah, it's something different at least.
Yeah.
What else? What other numbers are there?
One of my favourites is, I don't know what the song is called, I think it's Why Did It Have to Be Me?
Which one's that?
That's the one that Bill sings with her. It's clearly a memorable number for you.
Yeah, clearly. Yeah. I mean, I didn't watch this like 4 weeks ago or whatever.
The choreography is like they're like shuffling on the boat. It's all performed on the boat. And it's when he's like, do you want to sleep with me? And she's like, no.
Okay. But I don't really remember it. But I'm sure that was great. what else is there?
What was your favorite? What do you remember being the one you enjoyed?
I'm having a hard time remembering anything other than fucking Fernando and Dancing Queen at the moment. I think the best one was just the whole sequence really when they have the actual christening for the baby, for both babies, two babies for Donna baby and Meryl baby. Wait, no, that's the same person. for you know what I mean. Meryl's baby,
yeah,
and Amanda's baby,
yeah,
which are two different babies,
yeah.
Because one of them is the same
But
person.
Through the magic of cinema.
Oh, this is too confusing. There's two babies, and they both get christened, but at different points in time, apparently.
I believe they call that a cinematic parallel being drawn.
I believe they do, yes. But anyway, during the time paradox of the christenings, I just enjoy that whole sequence. Because it's first of all, it was like, oh, Meryl Streep is in this. Okay. Great. Yeah. At first, I thought, oh, they just got on a green screen. But then, oh, no, she is actually there. Okay, good stuff.
Yeah.
I quite enjoy that.
The water shot is very... When it pans down and she's... I don't know what the christening fucking bowl is. The big water thing.
The holy water.
Yeah. They pan down and she's in that. And it did give me Zac Efron Bet on It vibes. I was like, oh, that's...
Very much so.
Could have been done better.
But then she is there.
Yeah, but why not just have her there? The shot looks so bad.
Also, very clearly a different church from the first movie as well. But all right,
Yeah. Oh God. Yeah, I didn't think about that.
Yeah. What was I going to say? That whole sequence is probably the best sequence of the movie. It's very emotional as well.
Yeah.
I did actually get choked up watching all that sort of stuff. And you know, because like Amanda Seyfried actually sees her mum and all that sort of stuff. It was actually very emotional. Quite a good sequence. Shame about the rest of the movie. But yeah. No, it was fine. It was fine. I actually quite enjoyed it, but it was I don't know. It was both good and bad.
I said this to you. I said in some ways it's better, in some ways it's much worse.
It's very true.
The way I take this is there's two movies going on in this. One is good, one is not.
Yeah.
The good one is the Lily James one, in my opinion, because there's a plot and stuff is happening.
Yeah.
And the other one, the bad one, is Amanda Seyfried waits for a storm and then has a party.
Amanda Seyfried tries to host a party, but there's a storm, but then it's all right.
And her fiancé... No, are they still engaged, I guess?
I guess they're married.
Are they married? Yeah, it doesn't really
maybe
say.
Maybe they got
it,
married. No.
Yeah.
Well, let's just see a ring on her finger at some point.
Maybe. You figure it'd be something they'd make a big song and dance of. Quite literally, actually. Right, but let's say so. Her husband, basically, one of the segued in plots so that they could do One of Us in the musical is just that they kind of Sky's offered a promotion, and for some reason he's not like. This massive grand opening my wife has spent months planning, years planning, to reopen this hotel in her late mother's honour. Oh, I forgot to book it off work. I'm in New York for some reason. And he also, what does he do? Does he say what he does? Because it's not website building anymore, is it?
No, just a vague corporate job, really. It doesn't matter.
I'm so good at my corporate job, Sophie, that they've offered me a temporary role.
Look, I'm here in New York. I'm wearing a shirt. I'm looking out of a penthouse window. What more do you want from me? I work in corporate. I just opened up the funny notes on IMDb.
Yeah.
And here's a fun little goof. Donna graduated from New College in 1979. However, women were first admitted to New College in October of 79. So she couldn't have been graduating. Well, there we go.
That is outrageous. Terrible. And one of the teachers is a member of ABBA. So I guess we can all... We can confirm that he is a bigot and a sexist. Yes,
exactly.
There's another app. There's two ABBAs in this, I think. Maybe there's more than two ABBAs in this.
I think there's always an ABBA in them somewhere.
Yeah.
They'll get him in there whenever they can. Bjorn or Björk or whatever all their names are. They'll all show up somewhere.
Pretty sure last week you said they're all called Bjork or something.
They are. They're all called Bjorn or Björk or something.
No, all four of them are all called Björk ABBA.
No, they're called the names of ABBA.
Yeah, right? ABBA's their like, surnames, isn't it?
Yeah, ABBA's their... No, ABBA's not their surname. They're all
no, as in, but the acronym of the name.
Yeah. It's like Andrew, Andy, Bjorn, and Björk, or whatever.
But Andrew.
Andrew, Bjorn, Björk, Anne, or whatever.
I think their surnames are actually just ABBA, Björk, ABBA, and they went. Oh, that's ABBA, I reckon.
What are Siri? Hey Siri, what are ABBA's names?
The members of ABBA are Agnetha Fältskog, Annie Fridlingstad, Bjorn Ulvaeus, and Benny Andersson.
I fucking said one of them was called Bjorn.
You did? Yeah, you did. That was the only one you said. The other one was apparently Andy, and then Andrew.
No, it was... One of them was called Annie as well. So
oh, Annie.
That right.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyway, Bjorn or Björk were there. They were having a great time.
Yeah.
What else happened in this movie? Donna got pregnant and then immediately found her origin story overalls. So that was great. We got an origin for the overalls.
Yeah, we did.
Not a lot else, really.
What do you think of the two older ladies in this movie and the two younger ladies who play the younger older ladies in this movie? Because I know you found them too much comic relief last time.
Donna's mates,
both old and new.
Donna's mates were used more sparingly in this movie, I thought. So I feel like it was better. They wasn't just fully "Wahey!" all the time. There was a bit of it, but it wasn't, you know, straight up and down. The weird, because fucking Julie Walters got with Stellan Skarsgård at the end of the last movie, they wrote in a weird storyline, how about she's always been in love with him since the day she met him, because they
love with him, almost uncontrollably in love with him.
Yeah, like, to a creepy extent.
Yeah. Really.
He's
got a boat!
That was pretty weird. But whatever. She likes cake. And that was actually pretty funny.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I liked that the other one, the taller one. I should know their names. I don't even know the actress's name.
Donna's taller friend
with the bob.
Yes.
I like that she's just...
Who's never changed her hair.
No, never, yeah.
None of them have ever changed their hair.
No, not a single one of them. No. Pierce Brosnan has the only one that dares to have a longer trim at some point.
Okay, yeah.
But yeah, Donna's taller friend, I like the kind of this movie infers, she's just been insanely horny for decades.
Yeah.
she just cannot stop. Yeah. But yeah, which is quite funny. A good line in this, "Please God, let your wife be dead." very, very fun line.
And then doesn't that guy say she is or whatever?
Yeah, it's Fernando's brother or something, and he rocks up and he's like, "Alas, my wife is..." As if you'd be like, I'm romantically interested in the person that just said, "Thank God your wife's dead." But yeah, he's like, "Oh yeah, she is, she died. And now I don't think I'm ever going to be happy again." And she's like, "I'm going to have sex with you."
Yeah, so give it 6 years.
Where would we'll they go? They do. That's fun.
Mamma mia, fucking...
One of us is here we going again.
Let me, Waterloo.
It's just set up war. It's just set up war. I'll tell you what, if you had to draft out a third one, what if you had to round off the Mamma Mia trilogy,
all right,
where are you going with that? What character are you flashbacking? What do you want to see?
Pierce Brosnan is dead. Okay.
They're just chopping down parental figures for Sophie left, right and centre.
Pierce Brosnan is dead. It's been 6 months since the first movie as well. Sorry, since the second movie.
Fuck, you're going back in time to eradicate him.
No. It's been 6 months since the second movie.
Yeah.
Pierce Brosnan is dead. It's been 10 years in real life, but the cast have only aged 6 months. The characters have only aged 6 months. The cast have significantly aged.
Okay,
the characters have only aged 6 months.
Got ya.
Everyone who's still alive is returning for Pierce Brosnan's funeral. Whilst they're at the funeral, they sing some songs. I don't know what those songs are. Someone else can figure that out. But they sing some songs.
Presumably, what's ABBA's songs or just any tunes now?
Just anything.
They've run out of this.
Yeah, just do one based on fucking, I don't know, Nirvana. I don't care.
fucking. No, I'm just picturing Colin Ferguson. I tell you what, everyone, this certainly smells like Teen Spirit.
So Pierce Brosnan's dead. They're all there for this funeral. There's not enough chairs, so that's a point of drama. So they need to find some more chairs somehow. And then they get the two remaining dads to come in a cup. And they finally get the DNA test.
This is at Pierce's funeral.
Yeah, both of which come back negative. So now we know, because he's dead and he didn't come in a cup.
And it turns into a tragedy. Both of them realise they've wasted the last 10 years of their life parenting a girl who isn't theirs.
By the powers of deduction, we know that Pierce Brosnan is, in fact, Amanda Seyfried's father.
Right.
And now, not only does she not have three dads, she doesn't even have one because he's dead. And then the movie ends.
Fucking, it's so... That's needlessly harsh.
No.
Oh, God.
It's time for a wake-up call for everyone in this movie, I think.
It's time for everyone to get fucking real with themselves.
Yeah. Here's my last note that I have, just looking through my notes here. This is all in caps, by the way. What the fuck? This whole movie, I thought Meryl refused to come back. What a fucking roller coaster. Anyway, that was bumming me out. What was your dumb question again?
I don't even want to do it now. We've even discussed things cooler than it. My dumb question was if you could recast any of the three iconic dads of this franchise, yeah. What actors are you choosing?
Do you know what makes this question worse? The fact that we pushed back this episode like about a whole week as well.
I had multiple.
You had so long and you still fucked it.
When I texted you when you said you were ready to record and I said, give me a mo, I took then a further 5 minutes trying to think of something before I went, this will have to do. But go on, you're so smug, but no answer yet.
All right. So who would I recast? Just what, any of the dads?
Yeah, let's go by three. So who are you replacing Stellan Skarsgård with?
Stellan Skarsgård, I would replace.
You can't. With... No other Skarsgårds are on the table.
I would replace with Bear Grylls. Because they're like the same person, kind of.
So he would have been. So it chronological like. It applies to the timeline of the thing. So he would have been about, I don't know, 10. How old is Bear Grylls now?
No one's ages mean shit. All right, Meryl Streep.
Get that on the recording.
Meryl Streep. I love Meryl Streep. She's one of the world's greatest. She's probably the world's greatest actress. She wasn't fucking 20 years old in 1979. All right,
that's true. That is true.
Yeah. So let's come on.
All right, fine. Bear Grylls is playing Bill.
Yeah, Bear Grylls is playing Bill.
Who's replacing Colin Firth? I have a Hugh clear Grant. Choice. I think I was going to say Hugh Grant. Yeah, it's a Hugh Grant role, isn't it?
Yeah, the other British guy, Hugh Grant.
Yeah. The other one we've got. We roll him out for rom coms every 10 years or so.
And then for Pierce Brosnan, let's say Daniel Craig, because why not?
I mean, yeah, I guess it works, doesn't it?
Yeah. So there you go. What a fun question and answer.
Ooh, thanks everyone. Sorry to round out the episode on an incredible low.
Yeah, let's hope that he has a better question for next week, when of course we will be discussing this. It's Source Code. We're doing Source Code. Join us next week for Source Code. It's on Amazon Prime if you want to watch it beforehand. All right, bye. So there's that. That's going to be a great time for all involved, I'm sure. Now, what you can do whilst you're in Waterloo is leave us a review, put it on iTunes, put it on Spotify, let us know what you thought of the podcast, but only if it's 5 stars or more. We don't care about anything less. Follow us on social media at Another Happy Pod. We're on Twitter, we're on Instagram, we're on TikTok. We don't do anything on those last two, but we're there. We should start posting on the Instagram again, though. That is purely Lawrence's fault because he got lazy and just keeps forgetting to upload.
It's an easy one to forget.
No, it's not. It's very easy. So there's that. What else do I need to say? Anything else?
Can we make any recordings a sound onto? I don't know how TikTok works. Can you make your own sounds, or do you?
You can make your own sounds. Yeah.
So maybe we need like a sound.
We need a sound to go viral.
Yeah.
So
and then like everyone can do the renegade.
So everyone, everyone can like write their own little scenarios over our sound.
I see.
So it's like me.
I don't even know where this is going.
So it's just a TikTok teen just saying me when I'm about to bus. And then it's just us saying something dumb like, oh, I don't know.
I'm going to bust.
So there you go. Put out on TikTok. It'll be viral in no time.
We should actually make this a TikTok. Just have it as the only thing. The most niche cut joke from this podcast is the only TikTok we'll ever upload.
Great, good stuff.
Me when I'm gonna bust. I'm about to bust.
Lovely. So yeah, do all that. Follow us everywhere. Another Happy Pod. And to play us out, of course, it is ABBA with that cult classic, Waterloo. Good night, drive safe. Say goodbye to your mum for me.
My. At Waterloo, Napoleon did surrender. Oh yeah. And I have met my destiny in quite a similar way. The history book on the shelf is always repeating itself. Waterloo, I was defeated, you won the war. Waterloo, promised to love you forevermore. Badoo badoo badoo, Waterloo, couldn't escape if I wanted to. Waterloo, knowing my fate is to be with you. Whoa, 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 Waterloo, finally facing my Waterloo. My, I tried to hold you back, but you were stronger. Oh yeah, and now it seems my only chance is giving up the fight. How could I ever refuse? I feel like I win when I lose. Waterloo, I was defeated, you won the war, fuck me. Waterloo, promise to love you forevermore. Waterloo, couldn't escape if I wanted to. Waterloo, knowing my fate is to be with you. Whoa, 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 Waterloo, finally facing my massive coup. So how could I ever refuse? I feel like I win when I lose. Waterloo, couldn't escape if I wanted to. Waterloo, knowing my fate is to be with you. Whoa, whoa, oh, whoa, 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 Waterloo, finally facing my Waterloo. Waterloo, knowing my fate is to be with you. Whoa, 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 Waterloo, finally facing my Waterloo.